Assalamu alaikum.
Peace be upon you. Ladies and gentlemen, since this is the first session, I do believe we gave 10 minutes extra to wait for people, but now we're going to start. And I'm pleased to welcome you here in the session that we're going to address education in the GCC, policies and strategies. During this session, we are having experts who are going to discuss several aspects in terms of the topic that we're discussing today, including privatization, relation between investment and education, in addition and development, of course, in addition to the relation between the education policy and employment policies as well, and the implications and disadvantages of neglecting the humanitarian aspect of education. As you all know, ladies and gentlemen, the world today is, it's a dry world, it's financial, and we are neglecting the humanitarian part of this. But we're going to discuss this topic from one of the speakers with us today, to the implications of neglecting the humanitarian aspect. I'm pleased to welcome all of you here, and on your behalf, I would like to welcome the speakers as well. At the end of the session, first, we have 20 minutes for each speaker, and at the end, we are going to have half an hour for questions and answers and any discussions that you like. First, I'm very pleased to introduce for you Dr. Ahoud Al-Asfour. She's the first speaker with us today. Dr. Ahoud Al-Asfour is assistant professor at the Public Authority for Applied Education and Training, College of Basic Education in Kuwait. She holds a PhD in higher education and privatization policies in Kuwait, comparative education. It's from Melbourne University, Australia, and she has a Master of Education Policy International from the same university as well. Please, Dr. Ahoud, the floor is yours. Peace be upon you, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Thank you, Dr. Khalid. First, I would like to extend my thanks to Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies for the invitation. The topic that I have done, it's in English language, but I was astonished that the conference is in Arabic, and they like kind of attacked the speakers who spoke in English. So I briefed and summarized my research that I wrote in English into Arabic language. Hopefully, I will not speak much, and you're going to understand as well. So I prepared everything in English, but now I'm going to present the summary in Arabic. In the name of God, I'm going to address privatization policies and higher education pressures in Kuwait, which is establishing private universities in Kuwait. According to what Mohammed Armehi mentioned in the first day of the conference, there are two reasons for the problems in the Gulf, the teacher and the political decision. My study address the influence of political decision on higher education in Kuwait. We have the law of private universities, how and where, and why the public universities law has been paralyzed, for example. And new numbers were added to the students that we already have in the public schools, which led to them being weak universities. During the two decades, the education systems in GCC countries, not only in Kuwait, has gone massive reforms and changes, which is allowing the private sector to open universities. The opening of the universities and this massive change has led to an increase in the number of the universities that has been opened. For example, in Kuwait, for example, the private universities has been emerged or colleges until after the issuance of the law, which is after 2000. And now we have nine universities out of 17 licensed universities. What's happening in Kuwait is a privatization for the services of higher education. And I'm really focusing on this term. Others might not agree with having the term privatization to describe the changes in higher education in the GCC countries. Before, I was one of those. And the main reason for this is the narrow understanding of privatization concept. But after referring to the privatization and its implications and implementation in all the world, it has shown to me is using the narrow definition privatization is what leads for us not to say privatization in Kuwait and GCC countries in higher education. Usually because privatization is usually linked to having low incomes and low resources, but this is not what's happening in Kuwait because Kuwait is a rich country. Privatization doesn't mean it's selling everything that the state have to the private sector. The transformation can happen through several methods, including transferring the responsibilities that were for the public to the private sector. In addition to all of this, most of the rich countries have moved to privatization in order to have competency in managing of its resources, mainly in higher education. So what's happening in Kuwait is providing licenses for the private sector according to certain standards in order to establish higher education institutions and universities. Most of the students who attend those universities, 80% of them are students who are sent by the government under the internal scholarship under PUC. In order to answer the questions of this study, I conduct an interview with 30 of the officials who kept pace with this process in addition to my interviews with educators. I have also gathered relevant documents like the privatization law and reports that were issued by several international organizations like the World Bank and International Monetary Fund, in addition to questionnaire addressed to students to check their opinion and the impact of establishing private universities. The results of this study is that the privatization law issuance in 2001 was in a response for internal and external pressures as well. But here in this research paper, I want to focus on the most important internal pressures that led to establishing higher private higher education under the supervision of the country, represented by the Private Universities Council in 2000, mainly because there were several attempts that failed in order to open private university in Kuwait. One of the most important internal local pressures, first, the increase in the number of the students, which led to huge pressure on the public higher education universities, which are not increasing their capacity according to the need for this higher education. We must not forget that our society is a young society, that the youth is 60% of the population. So the increase in the number of schools did not lead to an increase in higher education universities to accommodate this number. The second point is lack of coordination between the public policies and higher education policies as well. An example for this, it's very clear in the segregation law between the gender in universities that was issued This mention that there is an increase in the number of the students and the same capacity is still there in the universities. The lack of coordination, from my point of view, is due to a problem in the work of Al-Umma Council. I'm sorry, the speaker is speaking very fast because she's reading. Anyway, she's describing the problem that happened in Al-Umma Council. The question here is issuing the private universities law have solved the problem? Yes, establishing private universities in Kuwait had several benefits, including opening the opportunity for several students, mainly female students, whose the customs didn't allow them to go on scholarships abroad, and the students who were not allowed by the crowded universities to be included. So plenty of money was saved on the government. So instead of sending students on scholarship abroad, they are studying inside the country. It also opened the opportunity for the expat children to study in Kuwait without going back to their home countries. It also opened the opportunities for adult education. But at the same time, what's strange, till today, and even after opening 9 private institutions for higher education, the government is still giving the public university a huge number of students. And this also, in the same time that we are having this work, or not allowing to develop the public universities. So the increase in the number of students was just a reason for this, and the law was just doing something without understanding the reasons, without thinking of it on the long term. It was just a blind decision. So to summarize, the study reached an outcome that there is a gap between planning and implementation, and also between the reality and taking political decisions in Kuwait. At the end, I want to clarify, I'm not with or against any of the systems. I would like to say that I'm with the quality of education and equal opportunities wherever we have them, whether in private sector or public sector. And it's clear of what I've noticed in the two systems, the public universities and the pressure of the students, which influence badly the outcomes of the education. It's clear for me that the higher education represented by the internal scholarship rules is the one step away from the voucher system, and that developing the public sector is very far away from the implementation, and private sector are increasing and developing with this support of government. The problem is not having public or private education. Our problem is the lack of education culture, as was mentioned by Dr. Yaqub Al-Kundri in a previous session. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Dr. Ahoud. I would like to apologize for mentioning the name of another college. The doctor has spoken about privatization and privatization policies that is taking place in Kuwait. And what is happening in Kuwait is a privatization due to pressures of huge numbers of students demanding higher education, and this has forced the government to open higher education to the private sector, also due to a lack of strategic planning in terms of higher education strategies in Kuwait. Our second speaker, Dr. Allam Hamdan, is an associate is an associate professor in accountancy in the Bahrain public private university, has received several awards in scientific research, and masters and PhD holders in accountancy from the Arab Academy in the Arab Academy for Finance and Banking Studies. In the beginning, I would like to extend my thanks to the chair of the session and to the Gulf, the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies, to discuss issues related to education and related policies in the GCC. Concerning the paper that I'm presenting along with Dr. Samia is an extension to a study conducted by Dr. Sami in session one, day one of this forum, that spoke about the impact of investing in education on the and looking into the impact of investing in education in the individual's in the individual income, and usually we look at it from a macroeconomic level. The economic development, everyone agrees that the human development is an integral part to economic growth, and with researches through research studies, human element and the role of human element in economic development. Among the pioneers in this to this fact are corporates that started using the details of knowledge and scientific research to be utilized to create consumer products to acquire larger market share. Then the government started paying attention to the role of scientific research and human development in economic growth. Investment in education and economic growth, there is not clear agreement among scholars as to the role of higher education. Now we are talking about higher education rather than education in general. Education in general, everyone agrees that it plays a significant role in the development of a nation. However, the role of higher education in particular, there is a debate among scholars as to its positive or negative role in development. Several studies found that higher education is a luxury and doesn't really contribute to the economic growth as opposed to basic and secondary education, particularly in developing countries where basic and secondary education takes precedence over higher education. Several studies have stressed the significant role, particularly in developed countries, and several research studies conducted in the sub-Saharas and the African countries and developing countries found that higher education contributes to economic and social developments of societies. In the current study, we tried to survey the role of investing in higher education in the GCC countries. However, we forfeit this goal to another goal due to the lack of data, and we took the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia as a model for GCC countries. We said that is the largest GCC country, the most investing in higher education, and they worked to invest to create the human element that is capable of achieving sustainable development. The key problem is does education was a support to the economic development, and is it supportive to the development, or was investment in education is an output to development? In other words, is investing in education was a result, an output of excess resources, or was it a strategy leading and impacting into economic development in a society? This is in the stated in the problem of the study. As to the methodology, we have acquired fiscal, financial, and economic data over 40 years, starting from 1974 up to 2013. The study model was that is investment in education is the variable that we would study its impact on economic development, then we have added another parameter is the oil revenues, which we cannot overlook when it comes to economic development in GCC or rentier countries and Kingdom of Saudi Arabia in particular, that depends on oil proceeds on economic development. And then we have introduce other control parameters such as the population and the current number of students in Saudi universities. We have excluded students attending foreign universities. This is the basic study model, and then we have used several complex economic models. I will avoid them and try to simplify them as much as I can. The study was broken down into two parts, one descriptive and the other is applied. There was a positive correlation between investment and spending on higher education and the gross domestic product, and the relationship is very clear between the two. And to the middle of the study, we wondered which one influences the other. Before we conclude the study, we wondered which one influences the other. Does the economic growth influences higher education, or does higher education supports economic models? We have considered other tests such as causality tests, and we found that higher education influences economic growth and not the other way around. Higher education didn't reap its fruits yet in Saudi Arabia to be in a position that it can lead economic growth. Through the time sequence or time line, one of the most influential factors in the domestic gross product is the price of oil. From the establishment of the kingdom, it's the influential factor when it comes to domestic product. And the price and the proceeds of oil cannot continue forever to influence the economic growth. There is a point in time where the influence of oil proceeds to be the only factor that influences economic growth. There has to be other factors, and we found that this in our study. Another observation is that accumulation of capital in the past would impact positively on economic growth. However, we found that its influence started going south to the extent that it started to impact adversely against the growth development, as our investments in capital investments has become more and more. Many countries, particularly developing countries such as Algeria, we find the same correlation between the accumulation of capital and economic growth. You accumulate your assets and your capital investments where you don't really need them. What we want to talk about is investment in higher education in Saudi Arabia. We find that early in the beginning of the establishment of the country, it has a real growth, and it started reducing till it started having a negative impact on economic growth. The significance is that we invest in higher education more than we need and more than the return in investment, and therefore higher education became a load on economic growth, and therefore the relation became adverse. Now talking about the workforce and the labor that accomplishes economic growth, and some of educators or judges for unbiased to conduct an unbiased study, we have to factor in the workforce, not only the national workforce but also the expat workforce, and therefore we can't really include it in the economic growth model. The things would be worse if we exclude the workforce. overall, higher education in Saudi Arabia is over invested and requires rationalization and needs to be operationalized and activated more to contribute to economic growth. What are the ways to activate the role of higher education? There are models in developing and developed countries that have invested in higher education and have achieved satisfactory results. First of all, developing national human resources and technical or technological learning, and to move away from conventional learning. Second is to find or look for cheaper or less costly tools for education, such as open universities, online learning, and distance learning. Third is a careful transition from conventional public financing of higher education to a real participation of the private sector, public sector contributions, and to facilitate the competition among private universities. Finally, the final recommendation is what Dr. Noura Al-Mazroui has emphasized in day one, is to link education with the labor market, and the need for education should be related with the economic and social needs of that country, considering the real needs of any country. Thank you very much. Next.
Thank you, Dr. Hamdan, for this presentation. We are economical people, and we hope such we love such models. He talked about the role of knowledge, the human development, the role of the human individuals, and he has shown a model that explains the relation between economic growth and education. And now I'm glad to welcome our third speaker for today, Dr. Samia Costandi. Dr. Samia is Associate Professor in Philosophy of Education at Ahlia University, Bahrain. She is currently Assistant Head for Educational Quality at the same institution for the Quality Education Affairs. She received her MA and a PhD in Philosophy of Education from McGill University, Canada, and he has received award from the same university, from McGill University. Dr. Samia, the floor is yours. Thank you. I want to apologize. I'm going to address my presentation in because my functional language is English. The problem is I taught for 27 years. I taught and I learned in English. So in order to save time, I'm going to speak in English, but I'm going to receive the questions in Arabic. I'm here to serve the Arab country and the Arab students. So I don't have a problem regarding this issue.
Critical thinking began with a conversation. Theodore Zeldin, in his book, A Brief History of Humanity, tells us that creations, inventions, and paradigm shifts all happened, did not happen in a vacuum. They happened via conversations in different disciplines among scholars. What is the value of the human sciences? The human sciences are disciplines that spur and augment critical thinking and debate. They allow for the creation of awareness and of consciousness about identity and one's niche in the world. They push students towards self-actualization. They enhance the building of citizenship. Words of wisdom that are a century old. C.H. Haskins said in 1923, The essentials of university organization are clear and unmistakable. They have been handed down in unbroken continuity. They have lasted more than 700 years. What form of government has lasted so long? No substitute has been found for the university in its main business, which is the training of scholars and the maintenance of the tradition of learning and investigation. Almost 100 years later, words of wisdom by a prominent leader of a distinguished higher education institution, Donald Kennedy, former president of Stanford University, with whom Derek Bok, former president of Harvard University, agrees. By nature, universities are controversial places. Their success and failure draws intense public scrutiny, and because they really matter. That they are now much misunderstood and much criticized cannot be dismissed as a temporary bump in the road, nor can it be ignored. We must take criticism seriously and ask about its origins. At the outset of the 21st century, universities have shifted from republics of scholars to stakeholder organizations. This movement is serious, it's international in scope, and it's controversial. Senior administrators are modeling themselves after private sector corporate executives. Excellence in education is identified in terms of a goal external to education, namely to compete effectively in the international marketplace. Academic institutions conceive of themselves today as serving the needs of corporate capital in a new information age of global production. Universities in the Arabian Gulf, in particular private ones, have generally attempted to emulate universities in the West, whether those be American, European, Australian, or New Zealand ones. However, they end up imitating, which does not mean matching and surpassing. The curricula and specializations in them have been imported. They are not custom-made for the countries of the Gulf or their citizens, nor are they responding to the needs of indigenous populations. The watering down of funding for the human sciences is one of the problems we have inherited since our universities are copying the stakeholder organization model of the West. Not only do we not have specializations in the humanities, but we also do not have good answers to give students when they inquire about this dearth. In all of our current specializations, like business, IT, engineering, our own experience informs us that syllabi and textbooks constantly adduce examples that are not necessarily relevant to our students' lives, and this creates estrangement. There's a history to the watering down of the humanities in the West. I'm not going to get into it in detail, but there was the competition between the USA and the Soviet Union when the Soviets launched Sputnik, led to an inquiry by the American government into what's happening to their education, and then there was a whole transformation and a move towards instrumental science, and there was a directive in the National Defense Act, which came at the heels of McCarthyism, which was a horrible witch hunt of academics who were all put in jail because they were accused of being communists and all that. And they were imprisoned and ganged, and free speech was smothered. But at that moment in time, which was between 56 and 62, there was a complete dwindling of the funding of the humanities in the West. Ah, sorry. Okay. I'm just aware of the time. Okay. Okay, sorry about that. I'm sorry. So, funding for the humanities dwindled, and the dearth of support for the human sciences contributed to the movement towards hard science and technicization under the guise of objectivity and value neutrality. Clamping down on the human sciences and the funding of hard sciences and technicization was taking place, and technological advancements were propelled, financed, and reified as great achievements. The technicization of society, pedagogy, theory, and culture ensued. Neil Postman, by the way, wrote a beautiful book about this in 1992, Technopoly. He called it Technopoly, the surrender of culture to technology. Technicization of theory leads to, for example, in the field of philosophy, many branches suffer from an empty professionalism, excelling in ahistorical and non-political exercises, often justified through appeals to false excellence. The human sciences should operate in a concrete cultural environment able to influence procedures on an basis, which means practically, they should not entirely depend on normative criteria whose function can too easily become to hide ignorance behind a pretentious veil of value-neutral objectivity. So, the three-legged stool on which university governance stands are academic freedom, shared governance, and tenure. Now, the question is, are those being threatened by the shift in universities to stakeholder organizations? Many authors and researchers believe that. One of them is Carrie Nelson, who wrote, "No university is an island, saving academic freedom," where he was the president of the American Association of University Professors, and he relates so many examples of what happened to universities during the time that he was the president of the association, in terms of corruption, in terms of the interference of the corporate world in university affairs, in terms of how university deans and presidents sometimes recruited people for reasons that are not academic and in order to make profit for the university, because these people were in the marketplace. Now, McMurty presents a very important and cogent argument about what is happening in education. He says, formal education has been the training ground for business and labor positions since at least the late 19th century. This subordination of education to economic demands is an unavoidable requirement of any contemporary technologically advanced social order. With the increasing global competition in recent years, this imperative of educating the marketplace for the marketplace has simply become more demanding. In other words, it has hijacked education. Okay? And the global market system leaves society in a very real sense without its capacity to think. Yes, I believe that. And this is a controversial topic, and I am opening it up for discussion. I hope you will ask questions and we will discuss this. Because I do believe that adopting the market model is leaving the university and academicians with an inability to think critically. Okay? If society's education system is ineluctably determined by economic powers, then we face the prospect of an inevitable transformation of our educational process into an organ for the capitalist market, which it is already. We can all see that. With education thus subverted to a universalized corporate circuit of producing consumer goods for profitable sale, what can remain of the mental life of a university beyond or outside of this circuit? Now, some people will say, the opposing market view, of course, they will say, oh, this is not a takeover of education by external corporate control. It is rather, just updated requirements of what has long determined modern formal education, society's economic system. You know, they try to rationalize it. But McMurty rebuts this. He says, those who believe there is no contradiction between the principles of education and the principles of the market are actually implicitly accepting this contradiction. Under a covering generalization about the necessity of economic determination of public education in contemporary industrialized society. And this is obviously a metaphysical issue which needs to be discussed. Now, a brilliant scholar who died very early in an accident, unfortunately, he was from Montreal, where I lived for 17 years. His name is Bill Reddings. He wrote an excellent book called The University in Ruins. He never lived to see it published, but his colleagues published it. And he gives the example of Ohio State University entering into a partnership with Ford Motors. He clarifies that, how the term excellence, which we are all used to, because we are all going through quality assurance processes, and the word excellence is invoked maybe 500 times a day, if not 1,000 or 2,000, okay? He clarifies how this became something more than total quality management in the process through which the university became something like a corporation. And he says, he quotes the Dean of Business Studies at Ohio State University when she says that the university is not very different from a business corporation, but it is not identical to it. And he elaborates by saying, this is not an ideology in the sense that, excellence, he talks about excellence as being not an ideology in the sense that it has no external referent or internal content. Has anybody explained to you what excellence is? It's a vacuous concept, it's empty. Nobody knows what it is, it's ambiguous, okay? He emphasizes the vacuity of the concept. And the second example he gives from the Office of Research and University and University Graduate Studies at Indiana, Bloomington, where he says, and he quotes, the criteria that were adduced for someone winning a scholarship there. And one of the criterion said, excellence of the proposed scholarship is the major criterion employed in the evaluation procedure. Okay, now he says, this statement that I just read, excellence is the criteria, is of course entirely meaningless. Yet the assumption is that the invocation of excellence overcomes the problem of the question of value across disciplines. It means that excellence could not be invoked as a criterion, even if this were so, because excellence is not a fixed standard of judgment, but a qualifier whose meaning is fixed in relation to something else. An excellent boat is not excellent by the same criteria as an excellent plane, right? So, now, important questions. There was a conference in the Gulf, actually, and there were proceedings, and it was very interesting. The proceedings were published in 2011, and the editor, Thorstein Bortz-Bornstein, wrote about the crisis of the human sciences. He asked the following questions. What are the reasons underpinning this crisis? Is it the cuts in funding of certain academic fields? Is it the decline of theory or the falling number of students in certain fields due to bad job prospects? Is it centralization and over-professionalization and the disappearance of a critical environment capable of linking academic disciplines to the real world? Is it absurd evaluation processes that foster centralization and over-professionalization and create a sterile atmosphere by preventing interdisciplinarity or creativity? In 2007, Blakely and Kogan wrote a fantastic positional article in which they highlighted the implications of the shift of universities from republics of scholars to stakeholder organizations. They said, and I'm summarizing, radical change has taken place across universities in response to demands from diverse stakeholders and in response to ideological questions regarding the contemporary definition of a university. What is the contemporary definition of a university? Formerly, the ideal university governance arrangement claimed authority in its capacity. Which capacity? In its capacity to represent the professoriate as members of an egalitarian and autonomous disciplinary community. Hence, skeptics today feel that the focus on new ideals and policies based on those ideals have caused a breakdown of internal value systems. I believe that, I agree with them. There is a breakdown of internal value systems in universities that sustain academic freedom and independent critical scholarships. Remember, my colleagues, that critical thinking thrives in the human sciences. It thrives in the human sciences. No university that can be proud of its name today in the world neglected the human sciences, whether Oxford, Cambridge, Princeton, Yale, any university in the world that has a history, that has authenticity, the American University of Beirut didn't get a quality assurance or NQF to rate it until 140 years after its establishment. It actually built itself first Our universities are very young, and they're being taxed with a lot of paperwork and criteria that are not that don't make sense because the university has not had time to grow. It's like discussing a very serious topic with a two-year-old who cannot absorb it. We need time to grow. More challenges. Without more research on site, we need research on site to assess the structural changes and to assess whether radical change is indeed taking place or there is an organic growth sedimentation process that is going on. Today, in universities, the governance bypasses consultation. They do not consult in general with faculty. In the odd place here or there they do. And this may work in situations where there are crises, but such managerial practices do not work as common practice. We need research-based understanding of effectiveness. The word effectiveness, efficiency, etc. What do they mean in a university? We know what they mean in a corporate, in a stakeholder organization, but we need to inquire, what do they mean in a university? The penetrative quality assurance procedures have replaced the trustful relationships between academics and their institutions. And that is part of everyone's experience, I think. We need to address the interplay between the changes that are both structural and normative. And we need to also address the interplay between the individual faculty independence and institutional independence. We need to reward collaboration rather than competition. We need to focus, we need to understand that focusing on efficiency, manageability, profitability, accountability is not enough when dealing with the universities. Power has become centralized, while discretion and responsibilities have become decentralized. Recommendations. Walk on the same path that the Doha Center for Graduate Studies is forging. They created a whole program that gives master's degrees in the human sciences. I hope everyone will do that. Universities need to open more humanities departments, offer specializations in the human sciences. They need to encourage critical thinking. We need to not operate out of fear. We cannot operate out of fear. Ladies and gentlemen, the only place in the world where people should be able to discuss freely and without censorship and, you know, just discuss and debate and differ with each other, difference is important, diversity is important, is the university. The last thing we need is to follow the market. The market cannot lead the university. The university has to lead the market. As Dewey said a long time ago, John Dewey. Encourage critical thinking, encourage inter and multidisciplinary conversations, discussions and debates in forums like this one, are what will propel us forward. I'm giving you some examples. You will say, what do you mean open some humanities departments? What about the study of ecology, environmental studies, oceanography, desert studies, sociology, psychology, anthropology in the Arabian Gulf and in the Arab world? Build human capacities. Ingrain the concept of citizenship. Deconstruct misconceptions about work and build a new work ethics that sustains demographic strength. I find that a lot of people, whether in the Arab world and in the Gulf, don't want to be blue-collar workers and they consider it beneath them. You know, we have a mentality of everyone wants to be a director. Teach the Arabic language well in an interesting and modern way. Instill a sense of personal morality, agency, independence of thought, and business ethics in citizens. I teach business ethics and we talk about the three bottom line. Don't only seek profit and, you know, do your job legally and just get profit. You need to do your work for the society and for the environment. Appreciation of citizenship needs to begin at the primary levels, augmented at the secondary levels, and reflected upon and discussed through university. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Samia, for this presentation. The doctor addressed the importance of education of human sciences and the importance of human sciences in building cultures and critical thinking, and how the development of such sciences allowed to the development in other applied sciences. The doctor has also mentioned that GCC countries bringing the universities, the Western universities, and they are imitating what's happening in the West, neglecting the humanitarian aspect. And she addressed also the risks when the market leads the outcomes of education. I do believe here in GCC we have not even reached this stage so far. There are certain claims there is a gap between the outcomes of higher education and the need of the labor market. From my point of view, is the reason behind this is being a rentière state. We have resources, we bring these resources, we distribute those resources, and everyone takes his share, whether in the private sector or in the public sector as well. The public sector doesn't have a huge productivity and it's not qualified. So, doctor, we do have a need to create demand on such sciences. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm glad to introduce the fourth speaker for today, Dr. Adnan Jawareen. Dr. Adnan is an assistant professor in the economics department and at Basra University. Dr. Jawareen has written three books or several books on the topics of competitiveness, economic crisis, and sustainable development. He has as well published several academic research papers for peer-reviewed journals. He holds a PhD in development economics from Basra University. Doctor, the floor is yours. In the name of God, ladies and gentlemen, peace be upon you. First, thank you, Mr. Chair, and I would like also to thank the Arab Center for Research and Policy Studies for allowing us the opportunity to meet this vast experienced individuals. Our research is causal links between education and employment policies. We have conducted studies for the GCC countries. The importance of the study, is due to discussing two main things that all the countries around the world rely on, is education and employment. The importance of the study is also based on conducting a measurable study for the importance of the relationship that links between the education policies and employment policies. So in this research, we are going to try to clarify who is the influence that influenced the other variable, and the study aims at evaluating the situation of the educational policies and their link with the employment policies in GCC countries, in addition to identifying the strength and weakness of points in such policies. It will also focus on benefiting from the measurable models in order to identify the causal links and the relation between employment and education. The hypothesis of the study is based on that causal links between education and employment policies, the feedback that each variable is influencing and is being influenced by the other variable. This means that the education policies influence employment policies and employment policies is influencing education policies. So this is the model of the study that we have used. We have in our model, we have used the panel data for the sample that's represented by the six GCC countries for a period of 10 years from 2005 to 2014. And we have used the causality model or causality model. Actually, nowadays, there were huge changes in the economic. Before, all the countries used to rely on productivity. The economic now is based in technology and education. And this revolution or this transformation, I can give an example to it as what happens before from the agriculture economy to industrial economy. This required from us to update the skills for the labor market to meet this new revolution. In terms of the theoretical framework, which is the first aspect and the link between education and employment policies, we talk about the policy or the theory of investment in education. It talked about two aspects. First, that that we should ensure that investment is dedicated or is being given to the sectors and being given to the researchers that develop higher education. It's not the idea of just having investment. The other aspect is creating labor forces who can benefit the new modern technology, which is the most important aspect. There is another study that clarified the links between education and employment policies, is Barra and Lee study. In this study, it included 141 countries for a period of 10 years, and it has clarified that education is a very important determinant for the economic growth, that the education is very important, and having an education, educated employees is very important for economic growth. The statistics has shown that 88% of the graduates, they do receive job opportunities in Iceland, Switzerland, and so on, and 83% of this percentage in OECD countries. The statistic has also shown that the graduates receive higher income by a percentage of 55% of more than those individuals who have not pursued their higher education. And those individuals who have not completed their secondary education, they receive income less than by 23% of those who has completed their secondary education. In the theory of labor market, we have several markets, but we are going to talk about two things. We have the main market that attract the qualified and skilled, highly educated employees, and the second one is the secondary labor market, who attracted low skills and individuals who receive low wages. We have both of them in GCC countries, which we are going to clarify through our research. The link between education and employment policies is very important. In the previous researches that have been submitted during the previous days, there were kind of contrast between the researchers. Some of the researchers used to say that education is more important, focusing on education is more important. Others used to say that we should bring the education towards employment because we're facing a big problem, which is unemployment, which is we're going to talk about it during the research. Plenty of scholars and economists have mentioned that the increase in competition on the employment opportunities have obliged those who are seeking job opportunities to develop their skills. So there is a competition for job opportunities. For this, a lot of people have developed their education level in order to acquire a job opportunity, because having a higher education level means having a higher job opportunity. In this researchers, we have clarified that the consistent education policies, with employment policies are connected. So when we have a positive link between education policy and employment policy, the level of unemployment will decrease, and vice versa. If the education policies are not consistent and aligned with employment policies, this will lead to an increase in the unemployment levels. In terms of the situation of education and employment policies in GCC, we all know that the GCC countries have exerted a lot of effort to develop higher education level in those states. There are plenty of indicators that have proven that the efforts exerted by those countries were not in vain, rather say. In terms of educated personnel, we notice in the increase in the individuals who have literacy and literacy skills, adults 15% or more. As an average for GCC countries, this has increased from 76.33 to the other number that you can see in front of you, from a period from 1998 to 2015. This increase is a good indicator for the efforts that were exerted by those countries during the previous year. The country which has scored high between those countries is Qatar by 96.3%. In addition, the increase that has been achieved was the highest also in state of Qatar, from 80.4 to 96. So the increase was 16%, which is considered the highest percentage between the GCC countries. You will notice that we have Saudi Arabia and Oman, that the literacy have not reached 90%, but the other four countries, the percentage have been more than 90%. This is the education in terms of literacy, reading and writing, but in terms of higher education, as you can see in front of you, the GCC country has exerted a lot of efforts in order to develop this sector. In the academic year 2011-2012, the number of higher education institutions, 860 institutions with more than 1.5 million and 600,000 academic educators working in them. All these indicators has led to increase in on number of students enrolled in higher education, in addition to the number of students who were sent on the scholarship. I think, as you can see in front of you, we have a big increase from 5% in 1998 to 33.6% in 2014. I want from everyone to focus on this model because it's related to the next model. Here we will notice that the country who has achieved the higher number in the number of students enrolled is the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, then we have Bahrain, then Kuwait and Oman. And the country that scored less is the state of Qatar. The higher education is not with indicators, it's not with figures. As we all know, the quality of education is what's important if you want to talk about the quality of indicators for higher education in GCC and in Arab world. We noticed that in 2012, and in the international test for math, 12 countries have participated in this test, and none of the students from any of these Arab countries have not achieved the success score, which is 500. The highest score, it was 463, which is less than the pass score. In the Arab universities, we have only four Arab universities, which are part of the international ranking 1 to 1,000, which is 0.5% of the universities, less than 1% of the total number of Arab universities. This is an evidence to the decrease in the quality of education, higher education in the Arab world. I told you to focus on the previous model because it's linked to the next model. So increase of the number of students enrolled with the higher education, this led to an increase in the outcomes of the higher education and an increase of the number of graduates. The private and public sectors were not able to accommodate this huge increase of the graduates from higher education. You will notice in the coming figure that I'm going to present that the total of unemployment and mainly youth unemployment in the GCC country, you will notice that the higher unemployment rates are in Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, which has scored the highest rate in the number of students enrolled in higher education. And here you will notice it scores the highest in the unemployment rates. So this means that there is inconsistency between education policies and employment policies. And then we have Bahrain and Oman, also the same ranks as the model before. So the countries that scored high in the enrollment of students in higher education, they scored high in the rates of unemployment. So the reasons behind the increase in the number of unemployment between youth, to several reasons. The first one is a lack of matching between the skills that the graduates have and what's required by the private sector. Now the private sector is focusing on certain skills that the education sector must provide, because nowadays what can we benefit from a certain graduate who has education, but he's unemployed. He himself, what will he benefit from the certificate that he's having if he didn't find a job opportunity? So the education sector must provide him with the innovation skill, with the critical thinking skills to get a job. Also, we have the social life, or the nature of the social life that the GCC youth is living, relying on the government, relying on the private public sector. It allows or it drives the youth to think of working in the public sector, not in the private sector, because the public sector provides plenty of features and advantages and benefits. The incentives available in the public sector, it drove the GCC youth to prefer unemployment than working in the private sector. This led to an increase in employment. Now we have the work regulations that provide protection for the local workers and doesn't provide it to others is another reason. If you want to discuss the number of job opportunities that were provided between private and public sectors during that time, 2010-2014, we noticed that the job opportunities provided by the public sector were, as you can see in front of you, 4 million or around 5,600,000 or 5,700,000 for a period of 5 years. This is the number of jobs that were that was provided by the private sector in GCC countries. If you notice the number of citizens who are benefiting from this number, they are 22.6 only, are the, or is the number of citizens who benefited from private sector job opportunities. This means more than three quarters of the jobs were given to expat workers. In terms of the public sector has provided around 829,000. The citizens benefited from them by 65% of those job opportunities, and the higher increase was or benefiting was from Bahrain, 91%, and the lowest is in UAE. This clarifies for us that the private sector nowadays is owned one way or another by the expat workers, and now we need to have job opportunities for the citizens, and this is what the GCC is doing by obliging the private sector one way or another to employ local and national personnel. And the initiatives that were issued, like employing of Saudis or employing of Kuwaitis and other, or Qatarization in terms of state of Qatar, and although of all of those initiatives, we still notice that the percentage of locals in the private sector is still very low. In the third aspect, we have used the measuring model between the causal links between education and employment policies in GCC countries. In order to identify the type of this link, we used the Hei-Ziau causal model, and we took two variables. The first one is the spending or expenditures on education as a percentage of the GDP, which represent the situation of the educational policies in GCC countries from 2011-2013, and we add six other 6 years. And the other one is the usage of the labor force. In our study, the first prediction error, we have clarified that there is a causal links as a negative feedback between the education policies and employment policies. We have clarified that the two variables, each of them influence and being influenced by the other variable. As you can see, the first variable is that we have the equations in front of you, that each variable is influencing and being influenced by the other variable, as we have clarified. For this reason, when I said there is a difference between the researchers and experts and scholars, in addressing this point, is that the relation between the two issues is a negative feedback between them, and this, and we have others who focus on education and others who focus on employment, and actually they are both related. In terms of the future vision of the model, we have clarified that the education policies and employment policies are not going to change during the coming period of 2015-2020, and the trends are still the same with minor changes and according to the hypothesis that we have developed according this model. You will notice that all the countries that we have in the spending in education as a percentage from GDP, you will notice that this percentage have increased slightly in all the countries, but only it decreased in Oman. In regard to the future trends for the employment rates, it followed the same trends, increase in the employment slightly in the countries, which means the situation in the future will be as it is now. There is a study that was prepared. It clarified that in 2018, GCC will be need, or it will need to provide 1,200,000 plus job opportunities in 2018, and the private sector is able to provide 500,000 to 600,000 job opportunities. This means the private sector will provide 50%. And the public sector has to provide the other 50%, and this is difficult if the trends are still as they are now. If there were no huge change in the education policies and the employment policies, in order to make both of them consistent and aligned with each other. The outcomes of this study is that the education play a very important and vital and effective role in providing skilled workers who are able to adapt with the requirements of the labor market in the light of the technical and informational revolution that's witnessed by the world. The study has also proved that we have two-way causal link between the education and employment policies, and we have said that there is a kind of lack and shortage in the employment in the education policy in GCC, which led to having inconsistent between education policies and the need of labor market for employment, although that there is a two-way link between them, which led to an increase of the unemployment of educated individual in GCC. In terms of the recommendation, we should clarify that we should work in order to improve the quality and the quality of higher education, not the number of individuals, but the quality, and to ensure that is aligned with the requirement of the local labor market through establishing standards and accreditation principles and the quality control that should be applied to all higher education institutions in GCC. All of the GCC institutions have a quality assurance measure, but did such measures has led our universities to the international level? No. This means there is kind of mistakes or error somewhere. We should focus where is the gap and how can we develop such institutions to keep pace with the international institutions. We should also provide a type of balance between the outcomes of education and the labor market through decreasing the number of graduates in the disciplines that the labor market doesn't need. I disagree with what Dr. Samia has mentioned. So now we have plenty of colleges and departments that have graduates, but we don't have job opportunities for those graduates. I don't agree. So I disagree with you, Dr. Samia, because the humanitarian aspects or sciences have less opportunities in comparison to scientific disciplines. And we have now a problem, which is the decrease in the number of graduates from scientific disciplines in comparison to humanitarian sciences aspects. We should focus more on the sciences and the humanitarian aspect. We have the needs, the doctor, the presenter is saying, engaging the private sector. Now, the private sector, actually, it's considered a development in GCC. Most of the higher education is institutions is with a hand of private sector, but this private sector should work to coordinate between the private sector and the labor market in order to provide job opportunities mainly for citizens. We have noticed that the labor market in GCC country is two markets, one for the expats that relies on cheap and low wages employees and others for citizens. And the percentage of the second market is less in comparison to the first market. Finally, I would like to thank you for listening. And now we open the floor for discussions and comments. Thank you, Dr. Adnan, for your presentation. He addressed the causal links between education and employment policies, the importance of education and technical education and economic growth. It's an important factor. He has also addressed that when we have a gap between education outcomes and employment, this will lead to an increase in the rates of unemployment. And he has also talked about the private sector. Actually, the private sector, its problem is a huge problem in the GCC. It provides around 80%. 10% of the workforce in the GCC, but 90% of these are covered by low-skilled, low-wages expat workers. And the reason behind this is that the private sector focus on quick wins by having two things, and the power of public expenditure and employing low skills, low wages individuals. So the incentive is there for the private sector. In terms of education and the relation of education and development, it has proven in the economic literature that the education is very important, and having an accumulation of the human capital and the human elements. And this is not, and the hindrance is not due to the lack of enough graduates or labs or universities, but we have poor demand, and the poor demand is due to having low incentive and motivation within the student to do like all this improvement. And this is for two reasons. The first reason is due to the not having a role of the private sector in the development, mainly in diversification aspect. And the second one is that having a very big low-skilled and low productivity public sector who are fighting for product and so on. So if you want to fix education, so you have to fix the sources that are demanding education, which are the private and the public sectors. It is more complicated than we think from my point of view. Just fixing education, bringing teaching, bringing international universities, this will not work. You should fix the public and the private sector, who are the sources for the demand. Both public and private sector require radical changes and political changes and reform as well. I'll open the floor for discussions. I will start from the right.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thanks goes out to the researchers, and actually a comment on the research by Mr. Allam Hamdan. It was revealed through the research study that that the accumulation of the physical and human capital has a negative correlation with economic growth. I don't know, but I believe the doctor can agree or disagree that half of the economic growth is due to the public sector. And therefore, how can we explain that the private sector would have a negative correlation with economic growth? Because the private sector is a for-profit sector. How is it that they invest on equipment or capital investments more than needed? And this leads us to the question. If the theories or the models that explains the modern growth models that talks about the relationship between the human capital and economic development by Lomar and Lucas models that talks about economic growth through the human capital. The other comment is related to Dr. Adnan's research. It's difficult to reduce the education policy only on investment in education. There are many variables, there are indicators that could be qualitative as well. Therefore, we find that there are some countries that spend less than the GCC countries do, and they have achieved and accomplished better indicators than achieved by the GCC countries. And thank you. Please ask specific questions. My name is Dr. Bashir Attai from Al-Basra University. My question is to Dr. Allam as well. I heard you talk about economic growth, and you consider that the gross domestic product is the economic growth. But actually, this expression is not accurate, as there is a difference between the economic growth and the growth in domestic gross product. The GDP. And therefore, the economic growth doesn't represent the GDP. And thank you. My name is Ali Watfa from Kuwait University. And actually, the presented papers are very interesting, and I would like to thank the panelists who have presented these great papers, and I would like to thank the chairman for his facilitation. I would start with Dr. Ahoud. You have presented the issue, the problem of higher education in Kuwait between private and public universities. However, with discussion, many aspects come to light. I would like to ask, do you think that these private universities are of true feasibility, and have they contributed to solving to what we call democratization of education? The other question is, in Kuwait we have only one university. Why? One public university, one state-funded university, which is the University of Kuwait, and now they are working into to establish. And the number of students population of Kuwait University is 35,000 students, and it's a very democratic university. The question is, why haven't the government opened other public universities? Related to Dr. Allam and all the economic papers presented, I have a big question here. We took the measurement approaches implemented in big countries such as the UK and the USA, and we applied them to smaller communities, school-based rentier, where 90% of the economic product depends on energy, gas, and oil. I believe, and I'm quite confident, that there are new planning approaches to study such societies. Therefore, I believe that all the results that more than one economic paper was presented must be skeptic about them. The same method, if you apply it in the UK, would be more feasible than applying it to Saudi Arabia. And education in our countries is not productive. It's consumer-based. It's to satisfy people and to employ people. It's not related to economy or growth. It's only to satisfy people's needs, such as the need for jobs and education. In the West, when you consider and study higher education, in the USA, for example, all the economic activities and the return of all the resources, industry, oil, etc., and the end on the margins, we calculate the impact of education. When you consider higher education, you have dropped the impact of education in general, as higher education is part of education in general. How would you calculate or factor in higher education without factoring in the entire educational system and its impact in economy. Second, when we consider universities, there are two basic fundamental points. You can't consider humanities as influential to economy, such as applied sciences that have a direct economic impact on economic life. Dr. Samia, I would like to thank you for this fantastic paper, and I wished that you would present it in Arabic. I really wished. I promise you, I have promised myself next year. When you started talking on the microphone, yesterday there was an educational conference in Kuwait, and honestly, in this educational conference, we were surprised by university professors from Korea, Malaysia, and I swear to you, they spoke in Arabic. None of us could speak Arabic as beautifully as they did. And they addressed issues and problems, local issues and problems, local to the GCC. I hope that you translate it so that we can, you can share it with our students. You would notice that in humanities we have inflation in humanities, such as in Kuwait University, 75% of students study in humanities. One moment and I will conclude. In Kuwait, and this can include several Arab countries, concerning Dr. Adnan, The concepts were ambiguous, were not clear, like, for example, employment, recruitment policies and educational policies. The word education policies is very ambiguous and foggy. I try to visualize this. It seems that I have taken more than, for example, in this context that you have studied and presented, we have a big problem that needs to be considered, is that the public sector, the Gulf people cannot work in it because it requires high expertise and pays low wages. And no matter how experienced you are, you can't really keep up on with the private sector. Thank you very much for your patience. Abi Isa Al-Mughaysib from Qatar, former dean of the College of Education at Qatar University. I have a couple of questions, and please be patient with me, with all thanks to the presenters. And I will start with the education economists. Yesterday, I've listened to Dr. At-Tamimi, and today I listened to Dr. Hamdan and Dr. Adnan. I have an observation that I believe should be considered in education economics. You're talking in your topics about the problems that exist in this area. However, the big problem is in generalization. We may generalize in our studies when we consider political, cultural, or societal issues. However, I strongly believe that we shouldn't generalize when we conduct a study on educational economics in the GCC countries. You can mention that this is Kuwait-specific or Bahrain-specific, but don't generalize it across GCC countries. The GCC countries are subject to variables that vary across each other. Every country has its own specificity. I'm talking here only in the economic aspect. There is also variation in economic abundance. It's true that we all share the word that we are oil countries. But who could say that oil countries are the same level when it comes to rentiering, etc.? Some of the countries suffer and take loans. Some, just like any other country that is not a rentier or oil-based rentier economy. There is also a variation in the demography across the countries. The ratio, the percentage, the percentage of non-nationals, 88% in Qatar, or Qataris or nationals in Qatar, only 12%, whereas in Bahrain or in Oman, we find it very different. And you have linked recruitment policy, employment policy, and education policy. We need to consider this variation as well. We cannot generalize. Job opportunities are vary. Qatar has excess in jobs, whereas a country like Bahrain or Saudi, as mentioned by the gentleman, they have unemployment, as admitted by some officials. These facts must be considered, and we can't generalize. You need. We welcome you studying GCC countries, however separate from each other. These are my comments. No, generalization is in oil.
You have
Mr. Khalid, yes, generalization is not acceptable in everything. You need to study the values, study the education, democracy, and politics. Yes, these can be brought together. However, economically, each country has its own special circumstances. Dr. Ahoud, I haven't listened to you from the beginning. I am one of the followers of the educational movement in Kuwait, and I have learned from the Teachers Association, and I have been keen to attend annual conferences of such association. Yes, I need the question, please. No recommendation comes out of these conferences, but includes a parallel education, parallel to the public education. However, today I was surprised when you were talking about the privatization policy as a foreign policy that is adopted by external pressures rather than societal pressures. I'm asked now, this makes me wonder about the product. Has there been any comparative study between the product of public education, higher education, or the product of private higher education? So if the product is better for the private sector higher education, then we should maintain it. I would, my question starts where you stopped when you said that educational reform requires the reform of the demand sector, particularly the labor market. And over the past 2 days, we spoke about the significance of educational reform. And let me please talk specifically about the state of Qatar. We found that several reforms have been witnessed in the education and the business sector. We are still conduct so many seminars and conferences, seeking the help of consultants to identify is truly there a gap or not. I have my question. Where is the problem? Where is the discrepancy after all these efforts and initiatives? So where is the discrepancy? Is the discrepancy in the lack of optimal implementation of such initiatives, or the lack of efficiency or lack of competency of such initiatives to serve the labor market and education at the same time? Mr. Chair, I just wanted to give her my turn, but thankfully she gave me the opportunity, and thank you. I have a couple of comments. The first one related to privatization. We see that there is a strong push toward privatization, and I believe the reason is that the GCC state government has been influenced very largely by the new liberalism. Is that the state government shouldn't be involved in social services, and this has its impact on the GCC state governments, in addition to other issues related to the rise of the security issues over other issues that has consumed or drained financial resources. So therefore, it's not purely educational, but also related to other areas. I believe there shouldn't be a problem if we have private institutions. The issue is related to two aspects. If privatization is to import permanently foreign institutions, I believe there are risks that we addressed in day one, and we shall continue to talk about them. However, if privatization means that there are two levels of education, a level for the poor who cannot afford but public education, and the rich that can go to a better education, it means that we are creating a problem that we cannot afford. In other words, if public funded education, not only behind private education, but rather at the same level or neck to neck. However, if if we assume that the rich can afford private education, where the children of the rich will become luckier when it comes to landing jobs in the future. The point related to unemployment. Unemployment is not related to education, and I believe only in a very small fashion. In the GCC, I believe there is the overwhelming expat labor force, which is five or six times the volume of national labor force. The other issue is the private sector's training policies. Our private sectors do not take up responsibility of training and development and giving time for their staff members to attend professional development and training. Unfortunately, private sector is quite selfish and very profit-driven. There is also another issue related to unemployment, and you know, Mr. Chair, there is the nepotism, and you belong to this family or that clan, and they all impact on the ethos of graduate students, no matter how excellent was he he graduates, he will always land such jobs. So the issue is much more complicated than just establishing link. Dr. Samia, I believe the issue you brought to discussion is of great significance and importance, and I believe it's the soul and the spirit of this conference. I will talk about it. I don't want to comment. I just wanted to emphasize that there are studies conducted in the United States of America indicate that graduates of liberal or human education are better in leading the financial and economic organizations than the graduates of management and business graduates. And this is a very significant study that points out that leadership can be good only when the high-level culture, the human high-level human culture, and it's not only about a set of information on how to organize and how to manage and how to govern. That's my last point related to economy, that there is a correlation and that higher education leads to economic growth. Because we are in a rentier economy, and the rentier economy varies a lot in other countries where economies are productive or production-based and knowledge. Now, when your economy is rentier economy, of course there will not be any relationship between higher education and rentier. You don't have a true economy. You have riches and financial resources that you distribute them according to loyalties. And when such rentier revenues stop, it means your economy stops. Thank you.
Please, you have 1 minute for the question, please. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Sharif Alihai from Oman. First, I want to apologize for the speakers who spoke at the beginning. I didn't listen to them. I was in the other session. I just heard Dr. Samia and Dr. Adel. I want first to extend my thanks to all the speakers, but first I would like to extend a special greeting for Dr. Samia, because what you have said, that the labor market should not the university, but the university should lead the labor market, I appreciate it, but what we're suffering from is by having it vice versa, that the labor market is managing or leading universities. In the beginning of the third millennium, there were certain slogans that education for labor market, and this is the result of everything that has started then. So the problem that we are facing now in terms of the low quality of higher education and neglecting the importance of the human sciences and building the human capital is what will stir the labor market in all sectors and not the opposite. The other idea is Dr. Adel's presentation. Labor market in our countries is the same. It will not change. There will be no compromising. We should not take it in consideration because it has certain economical ideas that doesn't serve the education policy. So we should focus on reforming education for having education for the sake of education, not for education about the outcomes of education, what those individuals are going to work in technology or engineering. No, we should reform education through education itself. Let us forget other external factors. Maybe I'm kind of very optimistic and platonic in this aspect, but I believe that building the human capital, and we should build everything through education, and then we will leave the labor market as it is to move and do it. Final question, please. Dr. Hatoun Al-Fassi from Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Currently, I'm international affairs professor at Qatar University. I want to comment on Dr. Samia's paper. It's a very beautiful paper, Dr. Samia. The idea that I would like to mention here, and I do believe it's related to human sciences and its problematic issue, is the quality of such disciplines. How can we talk about low quality for human sciences and it's not aligned with the international levels and the advancement that we have in international universities, which will lead, of course, to several problems. But linking between them and the percentage or the rate of critical thinking is the point that we should focus on. Why? Because we are lacking plenty of critical thinking skills that's built on freedom, and mainly the political freedom, which is in whether in GCC or Arab countries, mainly in GCC countries. We should not deny that the freedom and the critical thinking is limited. And this, of course, will lead to the low and the quality that we are talking about. And this needs to take other things in consideration. Thank you. Each speaker has 2 minutes maximum, 3, to respond to whatever you like from the questions that were asked. Let's start from the right. Bismillah. In the name of God, I would like to thank all the audience for their interventions. I want to start with Dr. Sami's questions in regard to expenditure or expenses on education. Why did we take these indicators? Yes, it's true. There are several indicators that influence education, but we can't include all of those in the model that we have used. So we have chosen the most important of which, according to the economical study, which is the indicator of the expenses or expenditure on education. As we have noticed that most of the international researchers said that the expenditure on education for the GCC is considered low, considering with the amount that's being spent by other international company, international countries. In regard to Dr. Ali's intervention, according to employment policies and education policies, this was the issue of the or the topic of the research. But as you know, I can't provide you with all the information in the short time that I have for this. In the research, there were a clean explanation for education and employment policies. The Doctor of Qatar talked about generalization. Generalization is not only in our economic studies, but in plenty of other studies. GCC or generalization in GCC is there because those countries share similar features in plenty of things. In the European countries, we notice that they do have researchers that discuss all the European countries, but those European countries are different with their different features and different characteristic. But we also find as well researchers and books around the Arab countries, although that we have a huge difference between those countries. So we have identified that each country, what are the features in this country and characteristics. For example, Saudi Arabia, it has higher unemployment. Qatar is the lower unemployment. So after we have generalized, we have specified in the case study that we have under demographics, as you have that you have mentioned, we have clarified that the expat workers in UAE and Qatar are much more than the citizens. In terms of the intervention that was mentioned in regard to the private sector, we all know that it's a profit sector. The private sector is the profit sector. So when he finds a qualified, skilled employees, he will not conduct training and qualification for the local citizens. And for this, we have all this localization policies in order that's being presented by the government in order to oblige the private sector to implement them. In terms of the rentier economies, we all know that we have rentier economies, so we should work accordingly. We do have this as a fact, and we have UAE was able to diversify its economy. The state of Qatar has reached an advanced stage in diversifying the economy. We all know this fact, so we should work accordingly. Thank you. I would like to thank Dr. Ali Fakhru and the doctor over there. I didn't catch your name properly. I would like to thank you for agreeing with my paper and agreeing with me that a better leadership, or as Dr. Fakhru mentioned, there are studies that prove, in addition to what I have addressed, there are studies that prove that the individual, when he's when he has a full education as a human, and by education we don't mean the formal education, he should not be like specialized in business or administration, he can lead better. In terms of critical thinking and neglecting humanitarian science, this on the long term will eliminate critical thinking in our universities. Our universities will not thrive without critical thinking. In terms of the doctor who has mentioned that in Kuwait, plenty of the students are majored in humanitarian sciences. Dr. Ali. Yes. In Kuwait, I'm talking in general. I was not addressing one country. I was talking about the GCC as a whole. The Kuwait is a rentier economy. The citizens in Kuwait, they don't need anything. They don't need to seek job opportunities. They have everything available for them. If they studied social sciences or not, they studied business or not, the government will provide them with everything, including students that I have supervised their studies in the PhD level. I knew their level. They studied PhD in our university, with Brunel University, and I noticed that this individual is very comfortable. He's not suffering from any problem. He said, I can take a leave from my work, the government will fund me and my work, and I will employ individuals to manage my office. I'm not going to do this. This is part of the answer, Dr. Ali. The problem in Kuwait is for the expats, what I mean here, that I have relatives in Kuwait, that's very hard. If someone is not working, he's not able to have the ICOMA or the residency, even if he's in Kuwait for 50 years. My cousin is going to leave Kuwait nowadays, although she's been in Kuwait for 40 years, because she's retired and she can't stay in Kuwait. So there are certain details that are very important on this aspect. I'm talking from a philosophical point of view and analytical point of view. I was not talking about GCC. In specific, I was talking about the whole world, how it's reflecting itself and on the GCC countries, because we imitate the universities as they are now in the Western societies, although we have not been through the years of development and building the disciplines that such universities have led. How a university of 15 years old or 10 years can do NQF and quality assurance? It's still a young university. The university didn't understand itself, it didn't analyze itself, it was not subjected to any self-critique. You can fill any form. You can say that you provide the best courses in the whole world, but the most important issue is what's happening inside the classroom. Even the Arabic that I have, I'm going to improve it. It's not why Dr. Samia, who is a Palestinian Canadian who studied in English school, why she can't provide lectures in Arabic. I love Arabic with all my due respect. I do read the literature, but my functional is English. But the question why my students in Bahrain, they don't speak neither Arabic nor English properly.
I will start by responding to the question from Dr. Ali Watfa. Do our private universities enjoy quality and democracy? They are still relatively new. The question with our Kuwait University quality and democratic university is since 1969. Unfortunately, our private universities are for profit or profit driven. The second point is why the universities are separated or the private and the public, they should be under the same quality umbrella. As we have the private education under the private higher education institution council, and they are subjected to two separate governance bodies, and therefore there is no comparison. I will move to Dr. Abdulaziz. I'm not against private universities. There is a possibility that they are good. Have there been a comparative study on the product? No, but I will conduct my PhD dissertation on the product of private or public universities. Dr. Ali, the societal problem of privatization, the rich and the poor, Kuwait had solved this problem as the internal scholarships program. More than 80% of private schools, private universities are Kuwaitis on government scholarships. And I agree that education is part of a holistic sector, and the recommendations of the monetary fund, they had clear recommendations, is that you need to move toward privatization. in consideration of the Kuwaiti constitution. And the Kuwaiti constitution doesn't allow this. We allowed it in such a way that doesn't violate the national legislations. I would like to thank all our friends for your comments on the study, and this is the objective, is to share this study with you, to go back with these feedback, as they are comments that related to the approach and the methodology, as Dr. Sami, the observation of Dr. Ali Watfa. I agree with you that spending in the GCC on higher education is consumer-based and no return is expected. However, the study came from identifying where are we now and what are the ways to improve in the future. I agree with Dr. Abdul Aziz that we shouldn't generalize across the GCC countries. It's true that there are several commonalities and shared traits. However, each GCC country has its own specificity. After that, some standard models can be adopted. By Dr. Adnan mentioned, we need to controlling parameters to consider each country's specificity. Thank you. And I would like also to pose a question. I have a small comment. When I was in my PhD studies, I was in California, and there were many Arab students there. And many of them told me, do you sell courses? How could you sell courses? And they were like two of them. And I inquired further, what are you trying to tell me? And he said, he said that they would they come to some professors, and they are non-Arabs, and the student would get marks without attending. So I told him, why don't you spend effort and you learn and you are free? He said, no, when we go to our countries, you know, it's all nepotism. It's irrelevant to receive education or non-education. This is to respond to Dr. Ali's question. Ms. Hind, also you asked a question, why do we have a malfunction, lack of policies? I believe the abundance of resources in the GCC countries have cancelled the need for tax and the need for investment in the national. When I talk about taxes, people think that I'm trying to impose or levying taxes on the nationals. I'm leading to another concept, is that taxation leads to accountability and controlling spending. Therefore, abundance of resources have negated the need to rely on the citizens, and the citizens started believing that they have a right to that rentier proceeds, whether they are productive or not, and such a right should be guaranteed and taken for granted. The private sector in the GCC, when the private sector used to pay taxes, they would contribute to economic decisions and development. But now it has turned into a private sector that recycles rentier proceeds and the contributions of the political elites. Therefore, you can imagine the outcomes. In conclusion, I would like to thank you all for your valuable contributions. And please, I apologize for those who haven't been given the opportunity to comment. Thank you.